Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
And welcome. My name is Ignacio Ramirez. I'll be your moderator for this morning's session, and welcome to Archetype Pattern Workshop. This is a school and it is not a church, and it will be affiliated with a church or religious organization. Now, this class is a result of a divine vision and revelation given to Henry Clifford Kenley in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. Since that time, there have been schools set up throughout the United States, Canada, and certain other foreign countries. Archetype Pattern Workshop was established in February 2021. Now, in this school, we use and teach by the true and original name and titles for the Heavenly Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name for the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has also been improperly substituted by God. And the true name for the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God, they are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are Lords many and Gods many. We now know that each Lord must have a name. Each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title. But unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in their alphabet that would produce the sound made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the death of the Messiah. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, he's incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolized in his pure spirit state on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. And this shape and form could only be seen in a divine vision and understood in a divine revelation. Later on, the self-same spirit manifests himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, who the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title could be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in the school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he called Moses on top of Mount Sinai and showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. And he instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. And we go forth in the school to prove that everything in the universe moves and operates according to the structure and function of the threefold tabernacle pattern, and absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. 10 aims of school are as follows. One is to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and as he actually exists. Two is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, modern, practical, and occult science. And fifth is to extirpate current superstitions, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensation and ages. And seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the dragon, the devil, or Satan, and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. And eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation of faith that was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. And ninth is to make known that Yahweh, from the beginning ordained, there is no other name given among men whereby man must be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. This morning we'll have prayer by Dr. Irene Ramirez. Our scripture lesson is Daniel, the 12th chapter. And our scripture reader will be Dr. Eunice Reiser. And we have a selection of music after the prayer.
Good day, class. We'd like to ask Yahweh, our Elohim, to give us that understanding, that wisdom, and that knowledge that we need as we get on in this world. Because it's hard out here, and we know that you know. But give us what we need. And we ask this of you. Because it says that, you know, just to ask, and ask in your son's name, Yahshua Messiah, and that we believe. So we need that faith and that more understanding that we do need. But give us what you feel that we should have for right now. And we ask this again in your son's name, Yahshua Messiah. Let's all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah. morning, class.
Good morning.
Our scripture lesson will be taken from Daniel, the 12th chapter, page 1042. And I'll be reading out of the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities in various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trainum. Daniel, the 12th chapter. And at that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince which standeth for the children of thy people, and there shall be a time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation, even to that same time. And at that time thy people shall be delivered, every one that shall be found written in the book. And many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. And they that be in structure shall shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever. But thou, O Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book, even to the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased. Then I, Daniel, looked, and behold, there stood other two, the one on this side of the bank of the river, and the other on that side of the bank of the river. And one said to the man clothed in linen, which was upon the waters of the river, how long shall it be to the end of these wonders? And I heard the man clothed in linen, which was upon the waters of the river, when he held up his right hand and his left hand unto heaven, and swear by him that liveth forever, that it shall be for a time, times and a half. And when he shall have accomplished crushing the power of the holy people, all these things shall be finished. And I heard, but I understood not. Then said I, O my master, what shall be the end of these things? And he said, go thy way, Daniel, for the words are closed up and sealed till the time of the end. Many shall be purified and made white and tried, but the wicked shall do wickedly, and none of the wicked shall understand, but the wise shall understand. And from the time that the daily sacrifice shall be taken away, the abominable idol that maketh desolate set up, there shall be 1,290 days. Blessed is he that waiteth and cometh to the 1,335 days. But go thou thy way till the end be, for thou shalt rest and stand in thy lot at the end of the days. I have read Daniel, the 12th chapter. Let us all say, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
All right, thank you for that, Dr. Eunice Reiser. And welcome again, those that are on YouTube and on Facebook, also Zoom. Okay, like always, we're going to lay a basic foundation before anybody gets into a lecture or showing something that Yahweh has showed them. Also, I've been watching the seminar back in Chicago Northside. I really got some things out of it. I enjoyed it. It was good. And it's good to be here, too, to learn about these things. As it was told to the audience back there, especially the last speaker, says, you got to come and sit down in these classes, personal. You got to come and sit and listen to this thing. You know, as Dr. Kenley says, you can read it in his transcript, that also in the Elohim book, it says, you can be transformed sitting right in your chair, you know, unto life, everlasting life, you know. And that's what the seminar was about, eschatology, the true meaning of eschatology. And as a whole, I got bits and pieces explaining eschatology, okay? And it was very good. We've been going on that subject pretty intensely, you know, going through those last three plates. It's a benefit that you do go through these things because it helps you understand. And the people that are running these charts, you could get something out of it because what we do, we listen for the Holy Spirit in a body. That's the other thing that Dr. Kenley stressed, because I've been hearing a lot of Dr. Kenley this, Dr. Kenley that. And one thing that we have to stress is that what Dr. Kenley says, what changed him when he seen this divine panoramic vision, this is not just a plain vision, this is a panoramic vision, meaning an unlimited view in every direction, okay? That he was changed. There was no more H.C. Kenley after he had this vision. In other words, it was Elohim in him, okay? When he walked around, he would say, "I'm Yahweh, so are you." The only difference is I'm fully aware of it and you're not. But coming to class, you'll be aware of it soon, okay? You understand what he meant by your Yahweh, okay? Just by looking at the chart, those that have been here for a while, you could see what he meant by your Yahweh, okay? That's why it has to be explained, because what happens, if you don't explain it, people go off. They go off and they think they could do anything because we say that the law's out. That's another thing. It was when I first came in, people were saying, the law's out. You know, and that gave, oh man, it's a key to do anything, you know. Yeah, if people go make a mess, you know, what are you going to tell the cops? You know, Yahweh said, the law's out, you know, and they'll look at you like you're nuts. They'll be carting you off in some ambulance somewhere, you know. But the understanding, that's what we come to class for. That's why it's important to come and sit down if you can. Sit in one of these classes. That's support right. It, you know. And you can get a lot out of it, you know. I felt like I was sitting there at the seminar because I was watching it, you know, all the lectures, you know. And, you know, it was pretty good. One thing that as I go through this the foundation thing, I'm going to show you that the guy from Ohio, John Quates? No, that's not John Quates, from Ohio. No. Is it Ohio? Springfield. Is it Springfield?
Yeah.
But, Lansing, Michigan. That's how I got missed. What's his name?
Terry
Welch, the director. Well, he's another director. Okay. He brought out something that I never seemed to, I didn't put it together until he showed it.
Okay.
Did you see that, right?
I think I know what you're
doing.
Yeah.
So, what I'm going to do, I'm going to go through the basic fundamentals. Basic, in other words, the elementary chart, which we call the elementary chart. This is the first chart that was painted when Dr. Kenley set up this teaching and he set up a school, okay? The chart, the plan of salvation, okay? And this is like everything in a nutshell, you know, the stories and the events that happen in the Bible, but according to a pattern, okay? A divine pattern, meaning straight from Yahweh himself. Okay, whenever you see divine, that means it's straight from Yahweh himself, or Yahshua, okay? Now, we also correlate it with this chart here, okay? The migration trek chart, okay? Which is a greater, more perfect sanctuary, tabernacle, which the universe in totality, which is angelic and physical creation, okay? Now, there's seven steps, nine principal vessels. Principal means they're most important, okay? There's other vessels in here other things, just like over here. There's other things in here too, a whole lot of things. But we're just going to look at these nine principal vessels. Why? Because they point to the nine attributes that make up this body. Okay? Hallow him. Now, the reason why we do this is because it leads you into a subject. Okay? You can springboard off this into a subject. Okay? And line it up by this pattern. Okay? Now, the first step in the tabernacle pattern is the gate that leads into the court roundabout. The second step is this brazen altar of sin sacrifice with four horns, and the high priest would take the blood there, and put it with his thumb on each of these horns. Okay, now the third step is this brazen laver of water, okay, which the high priest washed himself and the low priest, and they washed also the sacrifice. Okay. Fourth step is the door, or the first veil. There, they were this cup of holy anointing oil. Moses took it when this tabernacle was in the beginning of its operations. The high priest had to be anointed by Moses and the two low priests. Moses took this cup of holy anointing oil. It was a brass, and poured it over their heads. That way they could go through the door and officiate in the sanctuary. Okay? And the sanctuary is the fifth step. There you had this candlestick. Okay? It was like about 6 feet tall. Not just this little one, which lit this whole sanctuary up. Okay? During the night. Then the next vessel here we have is the golden table of showbread with a golden crown around it, which had 12 loaves of bread, okay? The next article here is the altar of incense. There you had the, was it four ingredients? Right. Four?
Yes.
Okay, anybody know them?
Galbanum.
Galbanum.
Frankincense.
Okay. So that was burned there to mask the stench of these burning sacrifice, and it'd be sweet smelling savior unto Yahweh. Okay. Now you have one, two, three. Okay. Three major vessels. Okay. You have one, two, three. Okay. You have the light, the bread, intercession. Blood, he said blood there, water, and spirit signified by the cup of holy anointing oil. Okay, so you got your six there. Now, the sixth step is the second veil. Okay, there you had angelic figures woven on them inside and out, okay, which is dividing the most holy place from the holy place. Now, when the high priest went up there once a year, he went up three times, once for himself, once for the people, and the third time for the cleansing of the sanctuary, okay? He didn't go up there without blood. There was a sacrifice that would be sacrificed before he went up there, those three times, on the Day of Atonement. Now, this whole thing here is the seventh step in the most holy place. There you had this three-in-one configuration, okay? You had these two angelic figures here, these archangels, which would represent the witnesses of Yahweh. And they'd be witnessing to the cloud here. You see the eye there, the Shekinah? When they would witness that flash on the Day of Atonement, when the high priest did what he was supposed to do and did it right, it would flash. Now, this is like a throne, so it's like the chest was underneath the seat. There you had the second set of stones which Moses brought down from Mount Sinai on his third trip with the laws written in it and through it, okay, on both sides. Seven on one side, three on the other. There you had Aaron's rod that budded, okay? And you had a jar of manna that was placed here in the Ark of the Covenant. So you have nine, okay? Nine principal vessels. And then we're going to correlate it with this migration trick, okay? Now, the first step in this migration trick is the door to the houses of the children of Israel, okay? The second is the blood on the door, on the two side posts, and from the basin. The upper post, two side posts, and from the basin, they had it, okay? That's your second step. Third is the Red Sea. See, they had to eat the sacrifice. Matter of fact, today's the 14th.
Right.
In other words, if we were celebrating this stuff, you know, it would be the Passover, okay? Take it on the 10th or the 14th, stay between the two evenings, you know, because the Passover was going to happen. In other words, that angel was going to pass over the land of Egypt and smite those that didn't have the blood in the inside of their houses, okay? And they had to eat this sacrifice. It was commanded of them to eat the sacrifice, okay? They had to be full of it. And if they couldn't eat it all, call the neighbors or anybody that, you know, could help eat it. If not, it had to be burnt up. Mm-hmm. It had to be consumed, either eating it or burn it up. Mm-hmm. There's principles there, okay? So you had the gate, the door with the blood, and the sacrifice. Then they had to take a three-day journey to the Red Sea. Now, they just didn't go out there blindly and walk in the night. They followed a phenomenal sight, which was a pillar of fire by night and a pillar of cloud by day, mm-hmm. which led them to the Red Sea. Now, when they got to the Red Sea, you know, you could read it in Exodus that they started getting worried about, you know, they had the mountains on the side of them and the Red Sea in the front of them, you know. And they started murmuring, and Moses went to Joshua, which is Yahshua, and told him, he goes, "Why criest unto me? Raise your rod," you know. And when Moses raised his rod, the Red Sea tunneled up and parted, and they all went through on dry ground into the wilderness of Sinai, okay? That's the fourth step. It's like a door, okay, or points to the first veil, all right? Now, they entered into the wilderness of Sinai, which is the fifth step, okay? There, we look for the principle of light. Well, that cloud that led them by night, which was a pillar of fire, you could read that it went and sat on Mount Sinai to give Israel light by night, you know, in a pillar of cloud by day. Why? Because the sun lit up the land, okay, and then the pillar of fire at night lit. They were never in darkness, okay? Now, that's your light principle. Your bread, like this table of showbread, right, for the 12 tribes of Israel, Yahweh caused it to rain down manna because children of Israel got hungry. They started murmuring to Moses that they should have just stayed down here in Egypt and eat off the flesh pots. But Moses went and he talked to Joshua or Yahshua and told him that he was going to rain down manna, and for 6 days they were to pick this up, okay, get an omer and enough for them to eat. And on the sixth day, to pick up twice as much, because on the Sabbath day, they're to do no work.
Right.
That was an ordinance, okay? They're to do no work. There is a rest. Now, that's a point, okay? And that's one of the things that I heard Dr. What's your name? Terry Welch say. I don't know if you're here when we had a discussion about in this plate right here when on the seventh day Yahweh rested. Adam and Eve were in perfect peace in the garden, Okay. And there's an angelic figure here. Were you here, Samuel, when we talked about this? And that they said, well, that's Yahshua, or that's the devil coming in there, you know? Can't be that way. This is a Sabbath day. What does Sabbath mean? Rest or perfection. Mm-hmm. You can't have imperfection with perfection. In other words, that's the adversary. So that we remove that angel out of there. Even, I think even in the plate we did, you know, because that wasn't right. That was a mistake. Okay? But we started scrutinizing these charts, you know, and there's certain mistakes that we got, you know, one of those 2520, some other things that we had caught and we straightened out. But that was like a revelation to me when I heard that, you know. The adversary couldn't be here until after the Sabbath. When he came up right. The third time and showed the adversary, you know, a recapitulation, but showed the adversary deceiving the woman. That was something, you know. That was something. Now, back to this, we have the second veil here, okay, which Israel went through the Jordan River. They took the Ark of the Covenant through into Canaan's land, or the Promised Land. There you had this 3-in-1 configuration also, just like the Ark of the Covenant. This is like a throne of Yahweh Elohim, okay? Well, here we have this Solomon's Temple. It was a porch, a sanctuary, and an oracle. And you had two, chapters or pillars in the front, like legs, you know. And it looked like, Dr. Kennedy said, it looked like a man sitting on a throne. Mm-hmm. And also, in here, in the sanctuary, or the holy place, the most holy place, everything was overlaid with pure gold. Okay? Just like you have the temple overlaid with pure gold and jewels and all this expensive jewelry and stuff, okay? And it glistened when the sun was at its zenith. It says that you could see this thing. It's like, you know, reflection. If something's reflecting from the sun and it's hitting this, it's like the sun on earth, you know, or you couldn't even see it because it'd be blinding to you. And so it's just like that principle. Sun on earth, okay? So this is like a throne, 3-in-1. So you have your 9 principal vessels, your 7 steps, okay? And that's our basic foundation. A foundation is like you're building a house. You have to lay a foundation. Back then they had a cornerstone, which would be the foundation, which they built off of. Sometimes, even in these modern times, when they're building some big old skyscraper or something, they put a cornerstone there to start the foundation, and they build off of it, just like in the old days, you know. So you gotta lay a foundation, then you start building upon that foundation. And you just don't build any old thing, okay? Because if an earthquake hits, that thing's coming down. Okay, so we lay a foundation, basic, good foundation, and you springboard off of it and run with it, you know. So that's what we hope for. Listen for the Holy Spirit speaking through a vessel, okay. That's what we listen to. It doesn't matter what they look like or anything, but you listen for the Holy Spirit, okay, or Elohim in that body. That's what we all have. You can't get away from it. Everybody here has that breath of life in them, which is Yahweh Elohim. All right, I'll be calling the first speaker. First speaker will be Dr. Marla Love. Okay, I'll call it Rebecca. Annalise.
I can just add it somehow, because I'm not going to be up here long. Good morning, class. It's been a while, but it's always great to be here. I just wanted to touch on something that the first speaker had said, and it just really resonated with me because we're talking about, or we had been talking about, the mystery of iniquity. And sometimes it's just so subtle. And the word like is very interesting, because you think like when you compare something that it's equal. Like isn't equal. Like is actually unequal. And the first speaker said that this temple, the dome, it, when the sun hit it, it shined bright like the sun. It didn't become the sun, it was like the sun. The mystery of iniquity was like the Most High, was not the Most High, but was like the Most High. Right. And we have to be careful in discernment, in that just because something glitters doesn't make it gold. Just because something similar doesn't make it equal. Mm-hmm. And so for me, I've had to look inward in where am I like something as opposed to being something or someone. Where am I like Yahweh as opposed to being Yahweh? Okay? Because we always think that the adversary is in someone else or something else, when it can reside within, because we want to be like, and not really realizing we are. Mm-hmm. That's my challenge. Because when I come up against adversity, I make the mistake of being like. And what I mean by that is I acquiesce to it. That's just the way it is. It's how it is. Not realizing that these attributes have been activated in me. Therefore, that's who I am.
Mm-hmm. You're right.
And so why am I trying to be like something? Like someone? I need to, and I'm, you know, I'm telling on myself. I need to be reminded every day when I open my eyes of who I am. Mm-hmm. I'm not like the things that are presented to me, what this earthly body has to endure. I'm not like that. I am Yahweh in a body. So just because it looks like the sun or it might shine like gold, don't mean that's what it is. We have to discern. And how do we discern? By we line it up. How does it stack up to the principles? How does it line up to the tabernacle pattern? When we want to test something, they have a test for gold, right? You can This the test. This the test. Where am I? That's the only thing I should be measuring myself up against. Not the adversity, not people, not places, not things, but this, mm-hmm. right here. Am I measuring up to this? Not like it. I don't want to be like it. I want to be it and have that knowledge and that understanding. So in Iggy putting the foundation of, you know, shining like the sun on earth, that's possible within yourself. But don't use it as a... you know, to fool. Yes. Don't use it to, oh, look at me. Look how great I am. Because it's nothing about me. It's not flesh. Right. It's spiritual. And I just want to constantly remind myself mm-hmm. to stay connected to that, to who I am. So with those few words, I hope you got something out of it. Thank you. And now our next speaker will be Marlon Love.
Fits my ear perfect. Thank you. Good morning, class. It's good to be here. There's a lot of things on my mind. Yahweh is invisible, and spirit is invisible, and we sense things, and we can perceive things, is why I asked Rebecca, however I asked her, and she had a little something to say, and it's been a long time, and it's encouraging, because I don't normally do that, and I had a gumption, I perceived something in offering in a roundabout way, you know, and I see it manifest, and it goes through, and it said what was on her heart and mind, particularly that like. It's another word I'm going to want is context. C-O-N-T-E-X-T. Talking about this like, this dome is like the sun. And it goes into the context because depending on who you're speaking with about that like. And as she ended up saying, you know, don't be sounding brash and attending simple and think you like brass, because brass has a shining like gold. You know, that's why there was brass down here in the court roundabout. You see, this is the physical, if you were, the earth plane. So you have this sun, and we have to remember that this temple dome shone because of this S-U-N. You understand? But yet we understand coming into this school and this understanding that this S-U-N only exists because of this son of Yahweh, or this Shekinah, which was the true light that the high priest had to see and recognize. That's what this temple and this son is pointing to, because Iggy said he went through this pattern, and Rebecca expressed that this is the measuring rod, if you would, of all things physical. See, this was a physical migration of the children of Israel, starting in Canaan's land and coming down into the Egypt and making that round trip back up in a process like into this tabernacle pattern, you see. And so these things we want to make clear to ourselves on a daily basis, as Rebecca admonished herself. And I have to do that for myself as well, on a continuous basis, you follow? And yet, I don't know how to want to express it yet or not. Something came up in the last class, the end of last class. How do I say to make it clear, scripturally so, about Holy Spirit. This is a name chart, one of the first charts that the founder had made to explain the name of Yahweh. You follow? Of Yahweh, the Father, of Elohim, a title, form as a word or son, and then Yahshua, which is the true name that was in the original Hebrew text, which replaces this erroneous name of Jesus. They're not the same. Like, Jesus is not like Yahshua the Messiah. You follow? This Holy Spirit is not like that spirit that keeps us animated day and night. It is the spirit. Mm-hmm. There ain't but one spirit. I'm fully cognitive of that. Mm-hmm. But we're making a distinction because this is a school or workshop or an organization to help somebody know something about somebody or something. He is the sole totality of everything. He's these divine attributes that make up the sum total of the whole creation. You follow? That was shown to Moses in the vision. You follow? And he's seen this twice, as it were. And he's seen the fall when that Luciferic spirit entered into the heart and mind of Eve. You follow? Unseen to Adam, but known unto Adam. Because Adam was Elohim. Mm-hmm. I need plates. I'm going to need that 14 at some point in time. Yeah, might as well bring it up. Make it right handy. See, I want to use the charts because I don't want it to be me saying it. And if I say something wrong, and I use the charts, and you have something to utilize as well, right? Because I'm not going to want to listen to you say anything either.
That's right.
Because I'm big enough boy to have my own ideas, thoughts, and opinions, imaginations. I don't need yours piled on top of mine. So therefore, we're going to try to use some scripture. That's why I'm slow to roll this way, because we want to use the foundation to convey the point. So we brought up about that like. And I don't want to try to be like Will. You understand? I'm not here to be like Will, Joe, my father, my uncle. I have a lot of people I can mimic myself after. But that's not what we down here to do. Because I'm not like this temple. You follow? In principle, sure. But trying to be this a thing is not my intention, right? So she won't want to be like the Most High. She is the Most High. And yet her caveat was to understand it. You follow? I need John 10 and 34. This is Yahshua speaking to the scribes and Pharisees about who they are. Start up about 33 or so. See if there's a context there. John. Now, understand why she's on, why we're pointing this, and Iggy pointed out that you said there was one time on the chart that there was a Lucifer, that they had an angel up here? Oh, okay. Was it on that chart that they had? Or they said at one time? At the conference? With that Luciferic spirit on it. Oh, okay. That was a good point. I had never thought about that either. I never saw an angel up here with that.
It's gone
now. Okay. So, nevertheless, these two plates, do you see how this six here is encompassing both of these two? Mm-hmm. Whereas every other number here of the days that Moses' vision took part is only one set of plates.
Right.
But this six is split in twice. Mm-hmm. You follow? Now, this small image is these two images here, plates 11 and 12. Everybody with that? Mm-hmm. Everybody fine with that? We understand that Genesis, the first chapter, he's expressing here with this plate. The recompilation of these 7 days, right, in a vision, and he sees this plate, as it were. This was the same 6 day. These two plates together. They just merged these two together. Because on this plate, we have them drawn up here. Look at that. We have Lucifer up here. He needed to come out of here.
Yeah.
As it were. You see? Mm-hmm. Now, we've been taught that these plates are upward, are descending and ascending. You follow? And so what we have here is an ascending plate. Right? Here, we have an ascending plate again. Because we're talking about the same day. So it got to be the same vision going the same way, as it were. Okay? And on that day, how should I express? You have them in eternity. Because this elementary chart, as Iggy explained, has pictorial illustrations of the events that transpired throughout your Bible. And we use this plate to here, or this tabernacle plate, in order to explain these things. Now we're using, and this most holy place runs right along with this set of plates. You follow? You have a holy place. Now I'm emphasizing holy and most holy because I'm talking about the Holy Spirit is what we're going to get into. Mm-hmm. And the question was asked, does everybody have the Holy Spirit? Okay? Mm-hmm. Now, again, we got the court roundabout, which lines up here with these lower plates. You follow? All the way across, depicting what we're looking for in the Spirit, because we're here to learn about Yahshua Messiah. Not that that hung on the cross, but that rose a quickening spirit is what we're learning about. We recognize he hung on the cross. Ain't no ifs, ands, or buts about that. But the question is, where is he at now? Where is he dwelling at? In the sky somewhere? Out yonder, whispering around like a Casper the Friendly Ghost? Where is he at? These are questions we need to know. And does everybody have him in them? Huh? Now, talking about this one Adam, do we have John yet? 10 and 34?
John 10 and he said he wanted to 33, take it up.
If 33.
10 and 33. The Jews answered him, saying.
See, we want to take the context. I don't want to just throw verses on you. I want to get the context. So I asked the scripture reader, hey, go up from 34 and find where you can catch the context. Now, we're talking about Yahshua talking to some Jews. He's not talking to the whole known world. That's in context, because this law that was given to the children of Israel was only for the children of Israel. That's a context that a lot of people throughout the world don't get. And I'm going to have something read out of the textbook here in a minute that's going to substantiate that point. So the context by which we're teaching is that Yahshua the Messiah is speaking to the Jews and the Jews only. Make that clear when she just read that verse 33 or wherever she's at. Continue on.
John 10, 33. Uh-huh. The Jews answered him, saying, for a good work we stone thee not.
See, for being good or being like a nice guy, we ain't stoning you for that. Why are you going to stone them? Read.
But for blasphemy.
That's speaking. That's what blasphemy is. You war. There was blasphemy up here in heaven in the first creation of them believing Lucifer, thinking he was the Most High, because he trumpeted up there in the most holy place, as it were. That's what trumpeting means. When Noah, we read over there in Ezekiel, the 33, the trumpeter or the watchman has to blow the horn. Right. We're talking about speaking.
Right.
Blasphemy is what Yahshua is accused of doing. Mm-hmm. Blasphemy of doing what? Read.
And because that thou, being a man, makest thyself Elohim.
See, they mad at him, just as Rebecca just got done saying. She ain't going to be like the Most High. She is the Most High. And they mad, and as a matter of fact, man, I've been contending with a guy just last night. Broke my heart. I really had to zip my lips. And this is right on line with what, let me keep on, because it's right on line with what's already on my mind. Keep reading. So you have these Jews mad at Yahshua, speaking blasphemous language, thinking that he's like the Most High. Keep reading.
34. Yahshua answered them, "It is not written in your law." I said,
"No." Reread that. Okay.
34.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yahshua answered them, "It is not written."
Is it not written?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Is it not? See, that's a catch-all right there. Mm-hmm. I'm not mad at the reader.
Yeah.
But sometimes we read this willy-nilly, and we don't catch those phraseologies or the context. That's why I had to. That's why we don't want to speak all the time, because we can't remember that. But that's the Holy Spirit being able to catch the context. Is it not written in your law?
Right.
That's how it's supposed to be said. Not that it's not written in your law. It's written in your law by the prophets that are you not Elohim? Read it.
Is it not written in your law, I said, ye are Elohim?
Yes. That's why that verse is up there on this chart. I had to go wander around, wondering, searching high and low for where, how can I prove what Rebecca say? I mean, I heard something similar to that before. I just walked right over to the chart. This is Elohim. I was told that this was Elohim. And then I read the scripture of Yahshua saying, "Are you not ye also Elohim? Is not written in your books that ye are Elohim?" And I bet you're going to find that in the prophets. Mm-hmm. Grab it. Read it. Psalms 82:6. Thank you. Very good. We help one another. Because we know that there's another tenet of this school, of the institution and the fulfillment of Yahshua Messiah. Because we know that Yahshua, in another context, totally out of context, that Yahshua came into institute, or Jesus came into institute. But we know that he come in to fulfill. There's a whole lot of context in there to explain that away from a person's egotistical, misdirected personality. Now we talk about the Holy Spirit now. They're living around and walking around just like you and I. Some more healthier than I am, as it were. Having some quickening within them, but do they have the Holy Spirit? Become the question. Just pause with that for a moment. We're going to tidy up with that. Read Psalms.
Psalms 82 and 6.
This is what the Jews had. This is the scriptures. From Genesis to Malachi. And this is Psalms written by David.
I have said ye are Elohim, for all of you are children of the Most High.
Now look, that don't mean everybody. Because I can go to John 5:39 and say the scriptures are about me, or Yahshua the Messiah. Now he talking about everybody. When a person read that, reread that and start at, what was that, 34?
Psalms 82 and 6.
Start at 5, please.
Psalms 82 and 5. They know not, neither will they understand.
But see, someone don't know and someone don't understand something going on about this stuff. That's why I say to do, Rebecca expressed, understand that I am Elohim. See, everybody has a spirit, but it's not termed or dubbed the Holy Spirit. Keep reading.
They walk on in darkness.
There, someone in darkness, read.
All the foundations of the earth are out of course.
All the foundations of the earth. This is the lower part. This is where Lucifer was cast out to. And Satan and his demons have complete reign of that, as it were. Described by Yahweh to do so. His mission, if you would, Lucifer or Satan at this time. Read.
I have said ye are Elohim.
Yes.
For all of you are children of the Most High.
Yes.
But ye shall die like men and fall like one of the princes. Arise, O Elohim, judge the earth, for thou shalt inherit all nations.
Now, Elohim's going to judge the earth. Elohim is Yahshua the Messiah. And we're to be like Elohim. Look, when Adam was formed out of the dust of the earth, right? He was the breath of life, right? The Holy Spirit, if you would, breathed into him or got into him, as we'll express and we often say. It wasn't CPR. It wasn't multiple breaths. He stepped into that which he created. You follow? He became a living soul. And he was all right. He was holy. And then he dwelt and named all the beasts of the field. Two by two. Yep. Huh? And it says here, Adam, the image of Elohim. Genesis 1 and 26, I believe, say, created in the image and likeness of us.
That's right.
You follow? Now, Yahweh, because of the purpose on that third trip, he comes down and puts that man in a deep sleep. Huh? Like unto death. Then he pulls out from his womb, or an immersion, or out of his womb, out of his womb, right? That's the death and then the burial, right? And then he resurrects this woman. Mm-hmm. Be a helpmate. A pair with him. Because there's a mission going on that is the purpose of Yahweh. You see this here? This chart is on a chart on a pattern or plan of salvation. This chart right here is not this chart. It's this chart, plate 15. So but we're dealing with this one because like Iggy expressed, Lucifer ought not be up in here. Mm-hmm. That's a correction, as it were. Mm-hmm. So now therefore you have them in a state of bliss. And we know that because when Moses came down this mountain the third trip, what was his garb like?
His face shone
like the noonday sun. Like the Most High. He had a full, he saw all the way to Yahshua the Messiah, but couldn't say a word about it to nobody. And he put that veil over his face.
Right.
That veil, we know, is a covering up of a reality of knowing or having something in you to be illuminated.
Yeah.
And that which illuminates you is the Holy Spirit, if you understand. That's what I'm getting at. We all got spirit. Yes, we do. But we all ain't got the Holy Spirit. And of the understanding in the context of what we're talking to and who we're talking to and how you're talking to. That's why last night I had to shut up with what I deemed as a friend. Fully aware of the name of Yahweh, but don't know diddly squat about Yahshua. Let alone what an Elohim is. Or how to see how that which Adam was, Elohim. But see him, why he like this? Elohim, don't we do that?
Yeah.
We cover up our faces like that. Elohim, they never covered up. But you see, that is what was lost when he partook or went against the law that was given to him. See that now? There has to be something to get back into. That Holy Spirit got to get back in a person. They still got spirit. He lived to be 930 years. He had to have something. Everything is spirit. But break it down. This is what we're expressing. Can we hit the air conditioner? I'm about to get hot. So you have this transition. That's what we got a veil here. Right? There's a veil here from inscrutability to scrutability. I believe that's what it says on this chart. Because that fall is parallel to this plate 14, the angelic transgression, right? The angelic invisibility is a veil here. It's invisible in this most holy place. You follow? And this is the division between invisibility and visibility down here. See, this set of veils go here, right? That's that set. this angelic invisibility is set up here at the transgression. This is why it says transgression here. Because when Lucifer transgressed, he was kicked out from invisibility to here. And this veil here is the veil between division between invisibility. You're still here, it's invisible. And down here now it becomes visible. Down here. You follow? So he's still invisible here, right? Just as when, and remember this too. Remember this too, that tabernacle that was shown to Moses in the mount. Mind you, this is the court roundabout. True? This court roundabout was all open. This here is the sanctuary. That one thing all by itself. We see this tabernacle pattern here broke up in three different parts. That's true. Sure enough, right? Huh? Court roundabout, all open, and in the sanctuary here, mm-hmm. right? And remember, this was shown for an example or schoolmaster to lead us up to the Messiah. Mm-hmm. But mind you, when they're in the most holy place, as is depicted here, I'm sorry about the camera, I got to do this like this. This was all, you see, it was one complete division. It was all connected. It was the sanctuary. The most holy place and the holy place. When that transgression fell, or Lucifer come out, or when Adam partook of that fruit and transgressed, then the veil went up. Then now we got our division. True? Mm-hmm. You see that? Now you got a most holy place and a holy place and a court round about. Now the stage is set. But remember when Yahshua died on that cross at noontime, this veil was rent in twain, giving us a pathway into seeing the reality of what Yahweh set up. But in the beginning, it wasn't always a veil. And I'm telling you that was the day of eternity. That mm-hmm. compartment was together. Mm-hmm. It wasn't until the fall that veil, that Lucifer or Michael set up to guard the way back into the most holy place. You follow? Mm-hmm. So these are the things that we're learning to see the context of what we're talking about. A Holy Spirit and not having a Holy Spirit. And we're not talking about it being academic neither. Knowing 2 + 2 = 4. We're not down here to have no fact-checking information that way, right? Or who knows more scriptures or anything of that nature. We're not dealing with that. We're dealing with understanding the purpose and the plan of Yahweh unto salvation. Because I said before, when Adam and Eve came out of here, they were ashamed. They were naked and not ashamed. They were innocent, you follow? But they were condemned in their conscience, nonetheless. Just like the world. They're not ashamed to do the things that they do. They're just condemned after they do what they do. They wonder why. They wonder, what's the purpose? What's the point? But they're still condemned in their mind. And they're innocent to knowing anything about Yahweh, you follow? Now, there was a law set up at a point in time with Moses when Yahweh gave them those 613 judgment statutes and ordinances that was a setup for the whole world to be able to come to a conclusion now, because we're not under these carnal ordinances anymore. The sin that was played against the mortal sin that Adam took on is also gone. But you have a context now that you got a lot of people thinking that we're still under this law of Adam. They still believe in that sin that Adam did. They still believe in the Ten Commandments and various other laws, statutes, and ordinances, let alone the ones that they done made up for their own selves. Right? But not realizing Yahshua came in to resurrect or regenerate that second Adam, to put him back in the bosom of the Father with the Holy Spirit. Now, the only one that was able to do it is Yahshua. This is why he's our Savior. We need a Savior, and Yahweh ain't saving. You see? In context, I think it's sweetheart. I have one up here too. I got two. Let me say that. I said that way because Yahweh's not saving. I say it that way because it's been expressed when Yahweh here took on shape and form of Elohim. He went out of the creating business. You follow? Remember, Yahweh is everything. We put a cloud all around the edge of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. Right? Mm-hmm. And when he created Elohim, Elohim went to work. That's why I say Yahweh ain't saving in that fashion. Right. I mean, we understand that this manifestation also took on a concrete physical manifestation known as Yahshua the Messiah in the flesh, you follow, at a point in time when he came in through the loins of Virgin Mary.
Right.
But that's not the only time he came in.
Right.
He appeared down here in Egypt at 30 years old, too.
That's right.
See, we follow in the spirit, not the literalness of what's expressed, because that's another contextual error, not realizing who Joshua, the son of Nun, is, that the whole world have no clue. They not realizing that it was the hand of Yahweh. Isaiah 63 and start at 9. No, go up a little bit further. See, we're talking about down here. Who led them up out of here? Isaiah. Who led them up out of here? And remember that we teach by the Old Testament or the Scriptures. And we know that we're looking at the five books written by Moses. Right? And we're looking at the subsequent 34 books for the prophets from Joshua to Malachi. Now we're reading in the middle here about Isaiah. And we're right around Isaiah 63 and I don't know.
7.
I think so.
I will mention the loving kindness of Yahweh and the praises of Yahweh according to all that Yahweh has bestowed upon us.
Now, mind you, Isaiah is writing, but we have to fully be aware Isaiah don't know dilly squat. That's the Holy Spirit manifesting through Isaiah to write what he's writing. So it's not in his opinion. It's Yahweh writing through Isaiah.
Mm-hmm.
Read.
And the great goodness towards the house of Israel, which he has bestowed on them according to his mercies. And see, according to the multitude of his loving kindness.
See, Yahweh's loving kindness wasn't to the children of Israel. He didn't say the whole world, and you can't put yourself in there. He's speaking to the Jews and the Jews only, known as Israelites back here. And it was his loving mercy that he set them up to institute what he's done with them. Down here, remember, this is Isaiah speaking. This is some thousands of years later, looking back at this event that we're about to talk about who actually led the children of Israel up out of here. To contextualize, the world thinks Moses did it.
Mm-hmm.
Talking about the context. Talking about being like something. Moses was like the resurrection, but Moses didn't lead them nowhere.
Right.
But they put Moses like the Most High. Or their leader, or the one. We're about to banish that right now. Read.
8. For he said, surely they are my people, children that will not lie. So he was their savior.
See? Yeah, well, Yahweh was their savior. He was set up. Read.
9. In all their affliction, he was afflicted. And the angel of his presence saved them.
Oh, the angel of their presence saved them. That angel was Yahshua the Messiah.
Right.
Keep reading.
In his love and in his pity, he redeemed them.
He redeemed them, this angel, read.
And he bared them and carried them all the days of old.
Okay, because he's reflecting about this migration that we went over with Iggy in the beginning. Read.
But they rebelled and vexed his Holy Spirit.
They vexed his Holy Spirit. What spirit was in them? Was they Holy Spirit in them? Because as I saw, Holy Spirit are going to have contention. Reread with that last sentence.
But they rebelled.
They rebelled. Didn't Lucifer rebel? Now, did Lucifer have the Holy Spirit? Let me ask that question. Now, if he rebelled, what's up, brothers? Now, if Lucifer rebelled and went against what Yahweh had set up here, then it wouldn't be no need for him to get kicked out if he didn't rebel. But he rebelled. Mm-hmm. We all agree. Over there in the 12th chapter of Revelation, talking about there was a war in heaven.
Right.
Michael and his angels and Lucifer and his angels. Right. And Lucifer didn't win. He had to come out just as Adam had to come out of that garden in order to start the purpose, in order to get that Holy Spirit back into the man. Just like that woman had to get back into the man. Right. Yeah, when she come out of the man, when he took her out of him and separated them, but made them one, and they were fine until that spirit entered it, or that conscience, if you would, that was set up to deceive and to bring down this operation. But now we're here to get something, to get a saving grace of a knowledge and an understanding of that which set everything in motion. You follow? And now we're reading Isaiah talking about what he already did. Read.
But they rebelled.
They rebelled. That means they didn't have the Holy Spirit in them. Read.
And vexed his Holy Spirit.
Vexed and made it unequal. Read.
Therefore, he was turned to be their enemy.
Oh.
And he fought against them.
Oh. Huh. King James said he was their shepherd. See, he took vexed out of it. I think King James said he was their shepherd. You see? So you got a shepherd here. Inside of here that is helping to lead us. This is a sixth step. This is a veil. And we need a shepherd. Just as that shepherd led them out of that land of Egypt.
Right?
Mm-hmm. It was there. That was their flock. We know that Yahshua, when Yahshua resurrected up out of Egypt with his mom and dad, that was calling in Egypt. He was fulfilling this point of right. Them coming up out of this land of Egypt. Can you come to fulfill? Read. Keep reading Isaiah.
Then his people remembered the ancient days of Moses.
Oh, then the people remember the ancient days of Moses. Huh? Read.
Where is he that brought them up out of the sea?
Where is he? They had Moses. Why are they asking if Moses was the one that led them? Why are we now in 2024 debating whether it was Moses or an angel or some other thing? Mm-hmm. There's no debate. Keep reading.
Where is he that brought them up out of the sea with the shepherd of his flock?
There, yeah, that's what I wanted. That shepherd of the flock that led them up out of here. That shepherd was Yahshua the Messiah. Read.
Where is he that put his Holy Spirit within them?
Now he put it within them. You remember, they remembered, though. They remembered. Right. Read. Mm-hmm.
That led them by the right hand of Moses with his glorious arm,
mm-hmm.
dividing the water before
See,
them.
That's why we got an arm here on this chart. Moses ain't doing that. The arm of Yahweh or the spirit of Yahweh is doing that. Read.
To make himself an everlasting name that led them through the deep. As a horse in the wilderness,
mm-hmm.
that they should not stumble. As a beast goeth down into the valley,
mm-hmm.
the Spirit of Yahweh caused him to rest.
See, the Spirit caused them or him?
Him.
Caused him to rest.
Mm-hmm.
Read.
So didst thou lead thy people to make thyself a glorious name.
He's making himself a glorious name. Not the children of Israel. You can be an Israelite all you want. Wear your purple and gold and chant in front of the Colosseum and say all you want to say. That ain't going to do you a hill of beans. Because we ain't talking about a name of Israel. We're not talking about Abraham neither. As far as being our Savior.
Right.
We're talking about the one and only, the name that the shepherd was called back here was Yahshua the Messiah.
Right.
You follow? And it's this same Yahshua that is the same Yahshua that transformed into out of pure spirit into Elohim in the corporeal, super incorporeal shape and form and manifested on earth for 33 and a half years. You follow? Fulfilling and not setting up a way of life right. or living, but to set up a purpose to understand what his mission is. Because he said, eternal life is to know the one true El and Yahshua, whom thou, Yahweh, hast sent. And no man cometh unto the Father unless you know something about the Son. You're not getting in over the walls. You're not sneaking in under the ground or portholes or anything like that. You've got to come straight in through the gate and look at you. Remember here in this vision chart. See, you give you and there's a mystery in operation. Ain't two spirits.
Right.
And we're not talking about two spirits. We're talking about one spirit. But then we have to talk about two manifestations. You follow? And you have a vision, the one unto delusion, consciously, and you have one unto righteousness or revelation. Because remember, the children of Israel remembered.
Right.
That's why they were given the promised land. They remembered the new offspring. Oh, man, it was so beautiful. I just got it. That's why he said, go back in there and find that. Remember, in Isaiah 63, he said, they remembered. Why I want to say it like this, because remember, those lot that came up out of Egypt, remember all of those? They came five abreast through here, mm-hmm. and they wandered around here and vexed Yahweh mm-hmm. for many years, 40 years, because they have no belief up here. Mm-hmm. Remember? But what happened with all those that come up out of here? Mm-hmm. They all died off.
Right.
Therefore, those that remember was that offspring, mm-hmm. that new birth. Mm-hmm. Just as we are supposed to have a new birth of our understanding according to the purpose of Yahweh by which he set up. And we see that, then we begin to have that Holy Spirit being manifested in you. It don't come all at once like it came with Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley. But don't be belly aching about it, because remember this Shaq and I right here, he had to do it every year, little bit by little bit, you see. And only did it the third time he went up in here. That's why we got to rehearse and go over and go over and go over until you get that, see that Holy Spirit take residence up into your heart and mind to get rid of all the, he did this to me, she did that to me, they did that to me, their places, I wish I could go there and live there, and all the imaginative things. Imagination that come into your conscious gets diluted and gets eradicated. You follow, in your consciousness, whereby your only Savior, your only husband, man, is the Holy Spirit. But you got to know how to express it. That's going to know the context, because a lot of Christendom, they have bits and pieces,
right.
but it's fragmented,
right.
and they tell you in the heartbeat that they got a Holy Spirit. They start jumping around and acting all kind of way. Just like my buddy talked about with me last night. What do I do? Why don't I go feed the homeless? That ain't my job. You reading the Bible and interpreting as well. That's something you're supposed to do. Because you think that he's instead of a way of living, a way of life. But I just can't say that.
Yeah.
I got to see it for what it is. All the Yahweh banter. It crumbled right before my eyes. I said, you ain't listening to a hill of beans I said. Mm. You think I'm supposed to go do right? There is no more law. See? That law was nailed to the cross. Now we're in a spiritual kingdom age. Ain't nothing I can do to gonna satisfy Yahweh other than preach the gospel of Yahshua right. Messiah and come and share with what you got. Even if it's a little bit, 5, 10 minutes, 3 minutes, go over something that you say you're rehearsing. We're in school. Otherwise, hey, you really ain't paying no mind. But come and share. Because what little that you may put out, I pick up. I watch the bits and pieces of the conference. Mm-hmm. And one guy on there, I've heard him before, But now he's on the floor. He went backwards. Because usually when I use this chart for me, I started here, right? I started here and getting to have the unity of the spirit, because this is a unity plate chart. Mm-hmm. And so I kind of wrap it up and get people to understand the unity of the spirit and how there's these three that bear witness of the one Yahweh, right? And then we go forth and work it backwards. This guy, he worked it this way. And I don't know what the prelude was, but his context was right. He just started right, and he had no setup. Just worked it all the way down yonder. Went over that unity plate, and then went back here and worked it all the way down here to eschatology, the end. Mm-hmm. You see, we ain't waiting for the end. The end has already done come. And you have to be in Yahshua the Messiah before it come. Because there ain't going to be no fixing when he comes and appears in your consciousness. Right. And it's not going to be televised neither. Right? Because this is the present kingdom on earth. The kingdom is already here. And that kingdom, you're supposed to have something in you. And that is the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. But unless it's in you, and you know for surety and can express it and understand it, is what we're contextually just talking about. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there has to be a laity. Not everybody's going to be able to rant and rave. I get it. But you can't, how should I say, That's good. That's good for Isaiah, I think. Read the next one. Next verse.
Okay. 15. Look down from heaven and behold from the habitation of the holiness and of thy glory. Where is thy zeal and thy strength,
mm-hmm.
the yearning of thy heart and of thy mercies towards me?
Mm-hmm.
Are they restrained?
Mm-hmm.
Doubtless thou art our father, though Abraham be ignorant of us.
Oh, Abraham was ignorant of us. Who's us? Keep reading.
And Israel acknowledge us not.
And Israel not acknowledging us not.
Thou, O Yahweh, art our father, our redeemer.
See, Yahweh is our father and our redeemer. And remember, there's no other name under heaven whereby we're going to be saved. And if you're not acknowledging Yahweh and you think it's some other name, do you have the Holy Spirit? Or are you vexating or blaspheming the Holy Spirit? Yeah, you breathing. Fido breathes in the backyard too, but Fido can't help you. Polly Wanna Cracker can't help you sitting up in a cage. Because it only repeats what you, it's like you. Because it repeats what you tell it to say. And that's why we can catch a person just saying Paul parroting up here. Paul parroting, parrot, that's where that comes from. You see? Keep reading. Isaiah got a lot to say in Isaiah 63. Read. Thy name
is from everlasting.
Thy name is from everlasting. You can't come run and tell me that your Lord's name is the Lord and tell me you got the Holy Spirit. It just can't be. They're breathing. They have a spirit, but it's not the Holy Spirit. Keep reading.
O Yahweh, why hast thou made us to err from thy ways?
He got you. We make us to err from our ways. Read.
And harden our hearts from thy fear.
Oh, yeah, they don't fear Yahweh. Tell a person name, Yahweh, don't make no difference. Yahweh, you got to tell him his name is for everlasting, for all generations. You see, he made them fall, Adam and Eve,
mm-hmm.
in order to start his purpose. It's not our purpose. He's asking, why, Yahweh, you make us err? Why do you harden our heart, Yahweh? Keep reading.
Return for thy servant's sake.
Return for us. Read.
The tribes of thine inheritance.
Mm-hmm.
The people of thy holiness has possessed it, but a little while our adversaries have trodden down thy sanctuary.
The adversary, that's this sanctuary, this temple. And this temple was torn down. That's why you can't, that's why you don't want to be like the temple. That's why you don't want to be like anything. And when Yahshua came back and said he's going to build it again or rear it up in 3 days, you got to know that he's not talking about this physical temple.
That's right.
That's the context of what we're expressing. He says a lot of things in that book. But just like I caught that, is it not written in your book versus not written in your book?
Right.
It's the context of how you say a thing and what it really means. Yeah. You follow? So we don't want to be like this temple, but yet we are this temple. You follow? It's the context. Because what's raised up is raised up in this temple. You follow? Or tabernacle. One and the same thing. Because, hey, principle-wise, the tabernacle had three functions or three parts, and this temple had three parts. There you go. They're the same thing. It's set like a throne, a man on a throne, because it's in a likeness of a man on a throne when Yahweh resurrected 40 days after 40 days tarrying on earth and resurrected unto the Father who's on the throne. Mm-hmm. Ain't never been off the throne. And that brings up another question or a statement that who's on your throne?
Right.
Huh? Lucifer ain't never been on your throne.
Right.
He, if anything, on a veil. Saturn in some instances. Or the one that got kicked out, if you would. You follow? Never sat on your throne. You follow? But that is on your conscience is on your mind. And that's not holy. Mm-hmm. It's blasphemous unto Yahweh if you don't know. Because that would be the sin of this age, of this world. Of not knowing who your Savior is.
Mm-hmm.
And that becomes problematic.
Right.
You start throwing up a lot of questions real fast. They had the same problem back in one of the conventions years ago. Somebody, you got to know Yahweh or you're going to be condemned to the lake. Scared a lot of people by making that statement. Oh, I don't really know who Yahweh is then. I don't really, brought anxiety to the congregation. But the phraseology, the context by which the speakers made that statement, they had to temper that. Just like they done changed this first aim to help you find and know Yahweh our Elohim as He. See, it used to be to help you find and know Yahweh. But people can't, at that time, they couldn't see because we say Yahweh is inscrutable and incomprehensible. Therefore, how are you ever going to know Yahweh?
Mm-hmm.
So they said, well, Yahweh Elohim, then. You can perceive, right? Because man could not perceive him in this pure spirit took on a shape and form. So mankind can perceive. He's still spirit.
Mm-hmm.
It's a knowledge about it. There ain't a Holy Spirit and just a spirit. So in the phraseology, the context, everybody got a Holy Spirit in them. But are they cognitive and realize it? It's the context of how you're expressing it. And depending on who you're expressing it to, it's all Yahweh.
Right.
But do you know Yahweh as He really is and actually exists? Can you avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, Satan, and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth? Can you discern for yourself? Many people can't discern. That's what makes them be void of a knowledge of Yahweh. This is what we're expressing. This is what we're laboring to get across. Go ahead and finish up Isaiah. We're almost done out of there.
19.
Uh-huh.
We are become as those over whom thou never bearest rule,
mm-hmm.
over whom thy name has not been called.
Their name ain't been called. You remember, Yahweh gonna call by name.
Right.
Everybody that's written in this book of life. And some people don't even know. Now, I'm not the judge, and I can't judge nobody or put nobody nowhere. That's not what we're expressing. But as we talk and express with one another, work up your context. Did you get the definition of context? Grab that before units to get the definitions. Grab me the first volume, page 4, where we said. Now, this is volume 1 of the textbook. On the 4th page, now I spouted about Adam and Eve here in the garden and how this too comprises of the 6th day, right? And Moses comes down when he sees them in eternity, as it were, in the garden, right? For 40 days. See, you got to understand how they were in the garden for 40 days at peace with the Holy Spirit in them. You follow? But Eve wasn't aware of that, though. Let me bring in that question, too. Eve not aware. Otherwise, she wouldn't have been beguiled by Lucifer. She would have been able to discern. See, you have to have the Holy Spirit in you to discern what is of not of Yahweh. This is what we're saying.
Yeah.
Friend getting mad last night at me, talking about you act like you're the only one to know the truth. By golly, you right. He ain't like that. Yeah, you can't go nowhere else.
Right.
Now you teaching. Now you're all in a wayward way. Yahweh ain't brought you that knowledge. That's between you and Yahweh. But we're talking about knowing your Savior. And you telling me that you're saving and you're doing right. I'm saying that's an error. You can't feed all the homeless. The Messiah said the poor you have with you always. You're not going to eradicate starvation.
That's right. Yeah.
Wherever your home might be, you're going to have people destitute and striving. It's a manifestation of the depraved minds and consciences of people. That's what that's pointing out to. People not knowing. Not everybody going to be saved. Right. Is the catch-all. Mm-hmm. And it works when they become like filthy rags. And they even going to cry out. What do you say? The scribe and the Messiah say, we've done this. We've healed in your name. We fed the homeless in your name. Yeah. And did all these great wonders in your name. He said, depart from me, for I never knew you. Right. Huh? And they say the name Yahweh real proud, like they didn't uncover something. Huh. Read the textbook. We got 15 minutes left. And this goes into what we expressed here about Isaiah, about the name Adam and Eve here. And when that transgression brought them out, and that conscious mind was changed from being and knowing Elohim to not knowing Elohim. That's what happened. They didn't have no relationship anymore with Elohim. Knowing that Elohim is still operating through them, making them have a righteous generation and an unrighteous generation for us now to be able to discern. They just said Abraham didn't know. Abraham had to wait for Yahshua the Messiah to come back and preach to him in the capital of hell when he was in Joseph's new tomb on them 3 days. That's the only way Adam and Noah and Abraham was able to get picked up. Isaiah had to get picked up. They just slept in the dust of the earth, not knowing the purpose of Yahweh. He told them, Peter, James, and John, when you seen the transfiguration, don't tell no man, because that time hadn't come yet, because he was still living. But he transformed in their consciousness. They saw eternity. They saw the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. But told them, hey, shut that up. Don't tell them. Why? Because when Moses came down that third time on the trip, he had to put the veil on his face. Hey, hold up. Don't tell them. See, Yahshua fulfilling that. This transfiguration fulfills this. Took me a long time to conceive that concept of this and this and how it's pointing to that, Yahshua.
Yeah,
man, it was beautiful. But it takes a lot of pressure off you when you see the righteousness of Yahweh. And now you have two mysteries, right? Or one of righteousness and an unrighteous. It's what we're working with. To draw a person into the mystery to see how it unfolds. See, this fulfilled here is by Yahshua the Messiah. You got to come in at the gate. That was the first step that the moderator, that Iggy talked about. You got to come in through the gate. You're not coming up through no peephole out of the ground into the sanctuary. You're not crossing over no ladder. You're not getting dropped down by no drone. You got to come in through this straight gate. You follow? And when we get in here, there's an operation that got to go on. See, then your righteousness or your filthy rags, all that you thought about, your egotistical misdirected personality, got to get burnt up on this altar. And you got to get the rightness of Yahweh. And that comes through man. And he said, we hope that the Holy Spirit will come and edify the body. It's not me. It's hoping through the gospel of what has been set up by the pattern for me to be able to articulate that which I'm articulating. So you'll see that it's the operation of Yahweh taking form and effect. It resonates with you, not me. I can't save a deal of beans. Now let them cook them up. But you can look at my antics. You can wonder about my past or my future or who the hell I am. But I ain't going to do you no good. Ever. But so now what we're saying is we got this issue and we all did not have the revelation until we had a delusion. You had to have a delusion first. And we got to get saved from this delusion because the Holy Spirit is not in this, is operating this mystery, sure enough.
Yeah.
But we don't want to be delusional with that lack of understanding of that that's operating. We want to get to this side. Now you become holy, having the holy words of Yahweh to express to somebody to edify them. Because they're not going to be able to read it out of the book. They're not going to watch a YouTube channel or any other such type of great technology that we have available for us today to ascertain these things that we preach. That's why Iggy and everybody say, you got to come sit in the seats. I'm so thankful that Yahweh had my dad to put me in the seat for however long that was as a little child. Bring one, come all. Young and old, sit them in the seat. Don't put them in the back. Put them in the seat. Because they didn't have no back room back there in 1040 South Grand back in the day. No, nevertheless. Right. Yeah. Yes, sir. So you got this righteousness, and it has to be the true gospel of the righteousness of Yahweh, because that's what's going to burn up and eradicate your egotistical, misdirected, your thoughts, your theories, your concepts, and your parenting. That's the first step. That's the death. That's the sacrifice. All those imaginations was the sacrifices that you developed,
right.
And they're innocent. You took hold like they were yours. Like. But you got to come up off of that and see the righteousness of Yahweh, whereby he may heal you, immerse you in the name, baptizing you in the name of Yahshua, Elohim, and Yahweh. Because we don't teach Jesus. You ain't seen me slip up there once talking about Jesus going to do anything for you. Because we say we use the true, correct, original name of that were in the original Hebrew text, and that is Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua. You may hear me flip-flop back and forth. Can't flip-flop because there's a righteous need under Yahweh to speak the truth. Anything else is blasphemous unto Yahweh. Giving anybody credit, giving Dr. Kennedy credit, is blasphemous unto the Holy Spirit. Therefore, they don't have the Holy Spirit in them if they're not going to teach by the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit ain't going to be fooled. Huh?
Right.
That's why we can discern. Huh? Agree with Dr. Kennedy said in the textbook. I don't know if he said this, but this is what they did on a synopsis to the whole world.
Volume 1, page 3.
Yep.
Yahshua the Messiah charged his disciples after his resurrection from the grave as a quickening spirit to go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing or immersing them in the name of the Father.
That's what we just said. We ain't baptizing them in a pulpit or a water. You baptize them in the name of the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. And it is by foolishness of preaching the gospel is the baptism you're being immersed in. You follow? Read.
And of the Son and of the Holy Spirit,
mm-hmm.
teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age or world.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, it has been the Holy Spirit, which is Yahshua the Messiah, or the Comforter, in those who are preaching the true gospel.
Read slowly here. Don't
Point.
Willy-nilly through here.
Point.
Catch it back up.
Okay. Therefore, it has been the Holy Spirit, which is Yahshua the Messiah, or the Comforter, in those who are preaching the true gospel of the kingdom, that has really done the preaching all down through this present age of grace.
Mm. Present age of grace, the kingdom.
Since Pentecost.
Mm-hmm. Since Pentecost. That's right. Keep reading.
We therefore, having this ministry, have had the awesome responsibility to see to it that this true gospel of Yahshua be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations.
We're live on YouTube, live around the world. However you want to fantasize about it, we're still doing that, which from the day of Pentecost.
Mm-hmm.
7 years later, to the Gentiles, which is prescribed by Yahweh, who's going to be the Jews first, then the other post, then the Samaria, and othermost parts of the world. The Gentiles coming in now 7 years later with Peter and his down there with Cornelius and his clan, right? And now we still doing the same thing. Call it boring if you want to, but you better believe that something's happening. Keep reading.
And then shall the end of the world or age come.
Mm-hmm.
Accordingly, we have gone on 3 ecclesiastical peace missions mm-hmm. in the past 5 years and have met with religious and political heads and expounded unto them this gospel.
Okay, so Dr. Kinley went on 2 of these 3, I believe is how the numbers go. He went in 71, he went in 75. Mm-hmm. And then I think guy in New York, Mitch, went in 76. Mm-hmm. That's when China should be in there in
75.
China in 75? Mm-hmm. Maybe Dr. Kinley only went on the 1 because he passed away in 75, right? He passed away in 75, so he only went on one peace mission. But keep reading. So these are the peace, this is the places he went, right? In 71, they went to London, Cairo, Egypt, Amman, Jordan, Athens, Greece, Tel Aviv. Yeah, I think he just hit them primary ones, and then they went, subsequently, a group of them went in 75 to those locations, and then 76, because Mitch talks about one of those coming back from one of those trips. Keep reading down through.
We boldly spoke the truth to these religious heads and told them of their errors regarding the true name of our Heavenly Father.
See, we've been doing that since the beginning, telling them of the untruth. Keep reading.
Yahweh and his son, Yahshua the Messiah, mm-hmm. of their error in overlooking the mm-hmm. divine pattern of the universe, mm-hmm. which is Yahweh Elohim, mm-hmm. and which was given to Moses as the tabernacle pattern stipulated in everyone's Bible.
See, that tabernacle was like, or the definition of Elohim. But we got to use this tabernacle pattern because it's the basics. It's what you're going to see Elohim be able to perform and why Elohim performed it based off the tabernacle.